they made God bless you this morning, to the Sunday school.
But I love the account of Charles Finney when he went into the warehouse there. And the power of God came down and began convicting souls. Not because of anything that Finney said. He was just walking through. But it was the power of God coming down. I can almost guarantee you that that came because Charles Finney found himself in a place of prayer and fasting. Brother Eli, the power of God came down because maybe George Fox was praying and fasting ahead of Charles Finney. Somebody was praying and fasting and knew what it was to get a hold of God. We can go to Elijah being on top of Mount Carmel with the 12 tribes, and he slays the 500 prophets of Baal. But take notice to what happened before the power of God came down. It was only like a 72-word prayer. Nothing great, nothing spectacular, no big these, thous, no tremendous words. Stuff like that doesn't happen typically unless somebody is praying and fasting to get a hold of God. If we're going to see God move, if we're going to see God save souls in our community in large numbers, if we're going to see the power of God come down upon this church and flow into the surrounding areas, it's going to be when somebody gets a hold of the God and starts praying, and not just praying, but fasting and really getting a hold of God. In the past, we've looked at the passages on fasting, which are in Isaiah chapter 58 and Matthew chapter 4. Matthew chapter 4 being Jesus in the wilderness. And we've looked at historical examples. Once again, we preachers, we have our favorite few, and that's about it. But John Knox, that man of God, the reformer, there in England, Scotland, who must have known what it was to fast, who knew what it was to definitely pray. Because the monarch, the queen, Mary Queen of Scots, said, "I fear the prayers of John Knox more than all the armies in England." Why is that? Because apparently somebody knew what it wasn't just to pray, but they knew what it was to fast as well and really get a hold of God. There's another account told of a landowner, I think it was England or Scotland, and somebody comes with a bid on the land, and it was half the price of what he wanted. And he said, no, whoever this is, tell him no, not for that price. Shortly after that, another offer came in for the land. Same guy. It was even lower than before. Landowner rejected it. Third time, a lower bid comes in. Landowner gets ready to reject it. He goes, "Before I reject this, tell me, who are you coming on behalf of?" The man replies, "John Knox." The man said, "You know what? Give it to him for that price, because if he and that man gets on his knees and pray, I'll have to give him the land for free." For a man or woman of God who knows what it is to pray and fast, there's power. And if we are truly, truly going to see revival, it's going to come in a time of prayer and fasting. We've seen in the past that there's no set days on fasting. The Bible records multiple days. 1 day, 2 days, 3 days, and 3 nights. Cornelius fasted for 4 days. People fasted for 14 days. Daniel prayed and fasted for 21 days. And Moses and Jesus fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. There is no set time on when to pray and fast. But if you do set a time, make sure that you keep it. Because it's better to make a vow than to make a, and keep it than to make a vow and break it. We've seen that there's several different kinds of fasting. And what do I mean by that? We were talking about with individuals. Because you can pray alone, pray and fast by yourself. You can pray and fast as a church. You can pray and fast with a friend. Or you can fast as a couple. When we look at the normal type of fasting, as in what to partake or in fasting not to partake of. The typical fast is no food but water. If someone would please read Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 through 2. Matthew 4, 1 through 2. And someone else find Luke chapter 4, verse 2. Luke 4, 2. Matthew 4, 1 and 2, and Luke 4, 2.
Then was Jesus led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was after work and hungry.
And what about Luke chapter 4 and 2?
Being 40 days tempted of the devil, and no day he did eat nothing. And when he were in it, he afterward.
So the normal fast is no food, but drinking water. Then there's the absolute fast, which is abstain from both food and water. We find this in Deuteronomy chapter 9 and verse 9. Deuteronomy 9, verse 9 and verse 18. And I will go ahead and read Esther chapter 4 and 16. Someone has Deuteronomy 9, verses 9 and 18. Go ahead and read it.
I was gone up into the mountain to receive the tables of stone near the tables of the covenant, which the Lord made with you. Then I abode in the mountain 40 days and 40 nights, and neither did eat bread nor drink water. And I fell down before the Lord in the first 40 days and 40 nights. I did neither eat bread nor drink water because of all your sins, which you sinned and did wickedly in the sight of the Lord, provoking to anger.
So here we find when Moses received the Ten Commandments that he did not eat, he did not drink. He fasted for 40 days and 40 nights and abstained from everything. In Esther chapter 4 and verse 16, the Bible states, go gather together all the Jews that are present in Shushan and fast for me, and neither eat nor drink 3 days, night or day. I also and my maidens will fast likewise. And so will I go in unto the king, which is not according to law. And if I perish, I perish. So Esther did not eat or drink for 3 days, 3 nights. And she also commanded the Jews tonight to also not eat or drink for 3 days or 3 nights. This is the absolute fast. There are some fasts that are, when you fast, it's between you and God. We talked about this last week. It's not for anybody else to know. Even Jesus stated that. Because we have the Pharisees standing on the corner crying out, oh God, have mercy on us. No, not him. That was the other one. But he was crying about how he's praying and this and that and the other thing. The Pharisees, they love to make a show of things. But then you have the publican with his head bowed saying, Lord, have mercy on me, I'm a sinner. Jesus commanded us to fast. He didn't say when you fast, not if you fast, but when you fast. Just like he said, not when you pray, if you pray, but when you pray. So Jesus commanded us to fast, but he also said, anoint your face with oil. You know, clean yourself up. Don't make it look like you're fasting. Put a smile on your face. Make sure you have a clean countenance. Don't walk around, oh, I'm fasting today. Yada, yada, yada. But he said, don't make it known. Because your Father, which sees you in private, will reward you openly. I've heard of men fasting. How long was that? How long did that man fast when you were in Taiwan? Do you remember? Is it 71 days or something like that? I've heard of people fasting for a ridiculous number of days straight. Am I telling you to do that? Absolutely not. But a fast is between you and God. And even if it seems humanly impossible, it does not mean that God will not sustain you. God will honor you. We have also the partial fast, where the diet is restricted rather than total abstinence from food. We find that in Daniel chapter 1 and verse 15. Daniel 1:15. If someone would go ahead and read that. So here we have the children of Israel pushing away the king's food. They were fasting. They were doing what their God commanded them to do. We've already talked about just food, no food, just water. I've also heard of people fasting for a very long time where what they did was they ate a very small meal at the end of the day. Just enough to survive off of. Nothing large. It wasn't like we do before we know we're going to start a big long fast. It's not like we know what we're going to, it's not what we eat when we know we have to get some medical treatment. We're not going to be able to eat the whole day because we all know at midnight you're not allowed to eat. So 11:59, you're breaking out the turkey leg, the Reese cups, and everything else in the house is scattered across the table. And people may laugh, but we all do it. We stock up because we know there's coming a time when we're not going to be able to eat. But this isn't that type of meal. But what you do is you pray and fast the whole day. Then in the evening you have just a very, very small portion, just enough to live off of. And you do that for multiple days. Now there are some people that, for whatever reason, they have to eat. When we look at the actual meaning of the word fasting, in the Greek, it means to abstain from something. Typically, it's food, but abstain from something. So fasting is not just limited to food, but it's other items as well. Whether it's activities we enjoy, whether it's things we love to do, maybe music we want to listen to at the time, something we have in our daily routine that maybe we push aside, that we enjoy, but we push it aside that we might get closer to God. Fasting is not just a pushing of something aside, but rather it's replacing it with something spiritual. And we replace it with prayer, we replace it with Bible reading, and just getting closer to God than ever before. When we pray and fast, we're not just praying and fasting to make our requests known to God. But if we are truly fasting, we're fasting for a reason. And if we are going to fast for a reason, well, then we want a response. And we're going to be praying and reading the Bible that we are tuning our ear and listening for God to answer from heaven. At the same time, while showing him how important the subject is to us, how important the matter is to our life, what it means to us. Like I said, there's multiple ways to fast. When we look at the results for fasting, we've already talked about some of my favorites. Like I said, us preachers, we have those few, and that's about it. We talked about Charles Wesley going into the warehouse. We talked about John Knox. We've talked about Elijah there on Mount Carmel. John Wesley tells us in his journal of a similar kind of deliverance in 1756 when it comes to prayer and fasting. The King of Britain called for a day of solemn prayer and fasting because of the threatened invasion of the French. Wesley wrote, "The fast day was a glorious day such as London has scarce seen since the Restoration. Every church in the city was more than full, and a solemn seriousness sat on every face of the city. Surely God heareth prayer, and there will yet be a lengthening of our tranquility. Then in a footnote he added later, humility was turned into national rejoicing, for the threatened invasion by the French was averted. The nation, the country there, faced invasion. They faced an enemy. They were going to be invaded by the French. And they came together for a day of prayer and fast. And God answered from heaven. And he delivered. When we look at the Azusa Street revivals, they met, I think it was for 42 days, everybody came to the home where John Seymour was staying at. And there, every night, they prayed. And they met together. And what a tremendous outpouring was the result of it. There are cautions to fasting, though. When we look at fasting, that's when we see the battle within ourselves rise up. The flesh versus the spirit. Because we all know the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. The more that we feed the flesh, the weaker the spirit is. The more we feed the spirit, the weaker the flesh becomes. But in those times when we are strengthening the spirit, when the flesh is weak, is stronger, we can feel the battle raging. Because the flesh is constantly trying to push on. It is trying to push through. Whether it's trying to avert us from prayer, whether it's trying to guide us through to food, whether it's trying to tempt us to break our fasting vow, the flesh is constantly rising up. To deny the flesh of its natural desires may cause us to be more in tune to hear the voice of the Lord. Would someone please read Deuteronomy chapter 9 and verse 18 and 25. Deuteronomy 9, 18 and 25. Deuteronomy chapter 9, verses 18 and 25.
I fell down before the Lord, and at the first 40 days or 40 nights, I did neither eat bread nor drink water, because of all your sins which ye sinned, is doing wickedly in the sight of the Lord, to provoke him to anger. Thus I fell down before the Lord 40 days and 40 nights, as I fell down at the first, because the Lord had said he would destroy you.
So the fasting, cautions of fasting are to cause us to get more in tune with God, but it places us in a realm more easily prone to the attack of the enemy. Now, as long as you're sitting in church, the devil's all right. As long as you're just sitting there doing nothing, he's all right with that. You know, there are some Christians that he just can't drag down to hell. There are some Christians he just can't make fall. But as long as he can get them to stay sitting in the pew and do absolutely nothing, he's fine with that because his kingdom is not under attack. You're just sitting there doing nothing. I'm just sitting there doing nothing. But guess what happens when we start praying and we start fasting? We start sharpening that sword of the Spirit. We start getting empowered. We start becoming weaponized. We become a mighty weapon in the hands of God. And that gets the devil's attention. And when we start praying and we start fasting, all of heaven is listening. We know in Daniel chapter 10, God heard from the very first time that Daniel prayed. And he's fasting there for 21 days, the whole time. Why did it take so long for the answer to come? Was it because God was using snail mail? God's internet speed was on dial-up? He was still trying to boot and connect? You can almost hear, still hear the beeps in heaven. while. Yes, I'm a 90s kid.
Because God wanted to see if he could people pray and not give up.
The Bible states that the answer came from the very first day.
Yeah.
But the prince of Persia withstood it. He held it back. The enemy, the devil, his minions, they were holding back Daniel's answer from heaven. They were preventing it from coming. Now, when we're fasting, when we are truly getting a hold of God, that's when the enemy is going to really, really strike. You know, he might battle us sometimes, but when we get serious with God, when we get serious not just in prayer, but in fasting, the enemy is going to strike. Jesus gets the baptism of the Holy Ghost. There in the river when John baptizes him, the Holy Ghost comes down in the form of a dove. And you can debate with that, that's fine. But regardless, Jesus is baptized by John. And he's led into the wilderness. And he's what? Having a grand old time during his fast? He's out there in his hot hammock, praying to God, and fasting. No. The enemy's attacking him. Three times he comes and tempts him to try to make him fail. I'll give you all the kingdoms of the world. If you are truly the Son of God, if you are who you say you are, turn these stones to bread. The enemy came in strong, attacking Christ. Maybe more powerfully than at any point in his ministry. We know that the devils came against him. We know that men came against Christ. But where else is it recorded in the scriptures that the devil came out and confronted Christ face to face? He came out from under his rock. He came out from behind his camouflage blind. And he began directly attacking him. And he did that when Jesus was praying, but not just praying, but fervently fasting. Fasting is an extremely valuable and important facet in the Christian life. But it is not infallible. It is not a blab and a grab. God, I want this Mercedes Benz, so I'm going to fast. God, I want a bigger house. God, I want my closet finished. It's not something. Fasting is not something we do to get what we want. It is not meant for us to throw, use as a temper tantrum to God. But fasting is to get closer to God. If someone would please read Jeremiah 14:12. Jeremiah 14:12. So here we have the children of Israel living in their sin. And God says, I will not hear them. I will not accept them. No, fasting is not a way to get what we want. And it's not a cover-up for our sin. When we look at David, he fasted all day for that child who lived, the one that he had when he went into Bathsheba. What David did was wrong. Could God have done it? Absolutely. But prayer and fasting is not a quick fix for God to fix up our mistakes. Can he do it? Yes. Will he do it? Maybe sometimes he will. But fasting is not something that we do for God to fix our mistakes, to fix us up, and to get what we want. Because obedience is better than sacrifice. But rather, fasting should be us trying to get closer to God than ever before. making sure that our requests are according to the will of God. And how do we know that our requests are according to the will of God when it comes to evangelism? Because God did not come to just give gifts to men. God did not